One of the most important facts about confession that you need to know next.
The program you are about to watch is part of a free series we are making available to you as a gift from Greg Fritz Ministries, entitled Saying What God Said. Visit gregfritz.org to download the MP3s and watch the streaming video for free by entering code FREE at checkout. Are you tired of hearing bad news? Tune into the good news of the gospel. Welcome to Good News with Greg Fritz.
Hello, I'm Greg Fritz. Welcome to the Good News program. We're continuing our teaching on this series, Saying What God Said. And all of these sessions are available to you with audio downloads or streaming video free of charge. Just go to my website and look for the free download button, and you can begin to watch or listen to these. You can see where we've been, and you can even watch programs that haven't been aired yet if you get that streaming link from my website. And to go along with that, we have the study notes, and you could take these study notes and those videos or audios and do your own Bible study. The study notes, if you've ever gotten them, they go right along with these sessions, and I think that they do a good job of turning these into a really nice outline. My notes are a little more sloppy, but they clean them up at the office and make them really nice. And you can take those and follow along with the teachings, on the program or to do a Bible study, and they work really well. The most important point, I believe, the most important fact on faith confession is this. And I want you to listen to this, and we're going to develop this for the next couple of sessions. And that is simply this. The Bible says, Jesus said, you have what you say. And it's so important to make that distinction. So we're talking about confession, and does it matter what you say, and how faith speaks, and we made those points. But it's important to understand that you and I, we have what we say. And that is a two-edged sword. The good thing about that is nobody else is in charge of what you say. You decide what you say. And you have what you say. And I'm going to prove that from the scriptures. Let's just go back to Mark chapter 11. Mark 11 and verse 23. And these are the words of Jesus. And Jesus, he really taught us the principle of faith in many places, but here in particular, Mark 11, 23, he said, "For assuredly I say to you, whoever says to this mountain, be removed and be cast into the sea, and does not doubt in his heart, but believes those things he says will be done, he will have whatever he says." And I want to put the emphasis on he. He will have whatever he says. Now, the context here is pretty remarkable. Jesus had cursed a fig tree, and he had gone up for figs, and there were no figs, and so he spoke to that tree, and he cursed it. And the disciples saw it and heard him. So they were walking back by the tree, I believe it was the next day, and Peter saw that the tree was withering, it was dying, it was actually cursed, and he was shocked. And he pointed out to Jesus, which, you know, like Jesus was going to be surprised. Peter said, "Rabbi, look, the fig tree which you cursed is withered away." And Jesus' response to that was a lesson on faith. It's so cool. He said, "Have faith in God." In other words, don't be surprised that I did this. You can do these things. And that's really what any teacher's trying to get across to their pupils, is not how great I am, but you can do this. This is not something that only I can do. And he's encouraging them to use their faith. He said, "Have faith in God." And then he just kind of upped the ante. I mean, they were impressed that he cursed a fig tree. And then Jesus said, "Guys, you could move mountains. If you use your faith, you can move mountains. You're surprised at this fig tree? You could move a mountain." And that's where Mark 11, 23 came from. It's Jesus trying to make an impression on their minds that this is something you can do. You can change your world just the same way you saw me curse that fig tree. You can do this and move mountains in your life. And so I'm going to read it again because Because Jesus was not shocked at all that he was able to curse a fig tree. Jesus was telling him, not only can I curse fig trees, but you can move mountains. And he says, whoever says, so that word whoever is the same word in John 3:16, whosoever believeth on him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Who does that mean? That means anybody can do. This isn't just for disciples or just for doctorates in theology or preachers. This is for anybody. Whoever says to this mountain, be removed and cast into the sea, does not doubt in his heart, but believes those things he says will be done, he will have whatever he says. Now, it didn't say he'll have whatever he believes. And if you've followed my teaching on these programs, you realize how important this is. Because we have talked about faith and how powerful it is and how it's the way we receive from God. And we've talked about the importance of faith and understanding faith. But I want to read this verse the way it's written, and then I want to read it the way a lot of people read it. It says, but he believes those things which he says will be done. He will have whatever he says. It didn't say he will have whatever he believes. You don't have what you believe. You have what you say. It didn't say he'll have whatever God said. God said a lot of things about you, a lot of great things about you. But you don't have what God said. If you did, you would have been saved since the beginning of your life. If you had what God said, you'd be completely blessed and you wouldn't have room for a bad day. If you had what God said, you wouldn't need anything and you wouldn't need faith. But it didn't say you have what God says. He said you'll have whatever you say. Now, I explained this in a session several weeks ago like this, and that is that we use filters to do searches on the internet or searches in a database. We use filters, and I use the example of hotels.com. That's a site I've been on a few times. And you can look up hotels in a certain city. So that's a filter. So you don't want to see every hotel in the United States or in the world. You want to see in a certain city. And then let's say you want to see 4-star hotels. So you put that on there, and that's another filter. So the hotels get filtered down from all the hotels in the world to hotels in a certain city. And then those hotels get filtered down to just 4-star hotels. And then you can choose from that list. Well, if you look at truth this way, what he's saying is you can move mountains, but the first filter you have to go through is you've got to believe in your heart. You have to have that faith in your heart. And faith comes by hearing and hearing by the Word of God. So in order to get into this position of faith and to walk this out, you've got to do your homework. And we talked a lot about that in the Dare to Believe series. You need to find scriptures that promise the things you desire. You need to know that what you're praying about or speaking is the will of God. And the only way to do that is to find it in His Word. His Word is His will. So let's say you've established that. So you've got all the blessings of God, and then you believe certain parts, certain ones. That's the first filter. You have to believe in your heart. So out of all the blessings and promises that God has made, only the ones you believe in your heart are going to work for you. You have to believe it in your heart. But it doesn't stop there. There's another filter. You've got to go through the filter of saying it with your mouth. So here's how Jesus said it. He said, if you say to this mountain, be removed and cast into the sea, and do not doubt in your heart, but believe. Believe what? Believe it in your heart. What? What you're saying. So you've got to have that part covered, that those things which he says will be done, then, you see, he'll have whatever he says. So once it goes through the second filter, then you start seeing what you are experiencing in your life. What is your actual life experience? What blessings of God are you walking in your life? And you can start with salvation. If you're saved, you did this. You heard that truth, you believed it in your heart, and you confessed Jesus as Lord with your mouth, and now you're walking in salvation. That's a reality in your life. And if you're baptized in the Holy Spirit, you heard about that and you chose to believe that promise in your heart, and that was established. And there are many of us who believe that it was for us long before we ever actually experienced it and confessed it and received it by faith. But at some point, you believed and you spoke, and now you've enjoyed that blessing. Well, did you know it doesn't stop there, that all the blessings of God and the promises of God are the same way? But in order to experience these blessings in your life, not only do you have to believe it in your heart, but you have to say it with your mouth and confess it. So that's why Jesus concluded this by saying he will have whatever he says. Or you could say, you will have whatever you say. You don't have whatever you believe. You have whatever you say. You know, it would be nice if we could just have what God said and there weren't any filters involved. We could just enjoy everything all the time, instantly. But the truth is, you've got to receive these blessings by faith. If you don't believe in divine healing, it's not going to happen. If you don't believe in divine prosperity, it's not going to happen. Jesus talked, or the Word talks a lot about victory. And greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. It says, whoever, 1 John 5:4, whoever's born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that overcomes the world, even our faith. So victory belongs to you, but it's not going to be something you experience without faith. This is the victory that overcomes the world, even our faith. So how does faith released? Well, you've got these two filters. You've got these two parts. First of all, you believe it in your heart, and then you say it with your mouth. That's why I say all the time, especially during this faith teaching we've been doing, you're never going to walk in victory if you constantly talk defeat. Why? Because that's not faith. You're disagreeing with what you say you believe in your heart. You're disagreeing with the promise of God. God promised us victory. He promised us that we would triumph. 2 Corinthians 2:14. He promised us victory in Christ. 1 Corinthians 15:57. He's promised to help us overcome in our lives, and in Romans 8, he talks about how we're overcomers. And so these things are promises that belong to us, but you receive them and walk in them by faith. So if you talk defeat, even though you believe in victory, you're not going to experience supernatural victory because you're really not confessing it, because you have what you say when you believe it in your heart. So you see how that works. I've said it this way, and I believe this is true. Let me read this again and make this statement. Assuredly, this is Jesus, I say to you, whoever says to this mountain, be removed and be cast into the sea, and does not doubt in his heart, but believes those things he says will be done, he will have whatever he says. If your mountain's not moving, either you're not believing it in your heart, or you're not saying it with your mouth. You say, well, that's just too simple. That's just, how could that be true? Listen, Jesus didn't lie. He told the truth. And if your mountain is not moving, either you're not believing in your heart or you're not saying it with your mouth. Because Jesus said, if you believe and don't doubt, you'll have what you say. And at this point in our teaching, we're really focused on saying it with your mouth. And I just believe that many, many Christians are believing the right things. They have the right doctrine. They understand the Word of God and they agree with it. But they're failing in the area of their confession. Maybe not on Sundays, but you know what? You're on the record every day. It's not just what you say on Sunday that counts. So if you're saying the right thing on Sunday, and yet the rest of the week you're speaking defeat and failure and doubt and unbelief and disagreeing with what God said, your faith is not going to work. And it's not because you're believing wrong, but it's because you're speaking wrong. So if it's not working, if this principle is not working in your life, either you're not believing or you're not speaking. And you could say the same thing about Mark 11:24, Therefore, I say to you, whatever things you ask when you pray, believe you receive them and you'll have them. And since we understand that faith is made up of two parts, believing in your heart, saying with your mouth, you could say the same thing about Mark 11:24. If your prayers are not being answered, I mean, God does His part. You can't blame Him. You can't say, Lord, you told a lie. You weren't being serious when you said that. Your word doesn't work. You know that's not true. God's word works. He does His part. So if your prayer of faith is not being answered, either you're not believing in your heart or you're not saying with your mouth. This is taking personal responsibility, and it's really important to do that in order to go forward in the things of God. And I know some people are not going to like the fact that I'm saying this because it does put the responsibility on us. But if that's where it belongs, I mean, it's not God's fault. You'd have to change the doctrines of the Bible to say that God wants you sick or God wants you defeated or God doesn't want to answer His prayers, your prayers that He's promised. You'd have to change the Bible. I'd rather take responsibility and say, Lord, the problem is down here. The problem is with me. And if I'm not receiving from God by faith, then there's a problem with me. I'm either not believing in my heart or I'm not saying it consistently with my mouth. And the biggest variable is your confession. You know, we don't change our belief that much. I've said it this way before, and I like to use this illustration. If you took a pie chart, a big pie chart, and it would represent all the doctrines that you believe as a full gospel Christian, as a charismatic, Pentecostal, full gospel, whatever you call yourself, word of faith, believer, we believe the Bible. We believe it's true. We believe that God does the same today as He's ever done. Jesus Christ the same yesterday, today, forever. We believe God does miracles. So if you took that pie chart and you put in it all the doctrines of the Bible that we believe in our heart, you would have a slice that would be salvation. You believe that Jesus died for your sins and He's a Savior. You'd have another slice that would be divine healing. We believe that God's a healer, that healing is for today. You'd have another slice of that pie that would represent prosperity. We believe that God wants to prosper and meet our needs financially. You'd have a slice that would be the baptism of the Holy Spirit. We believe that that gift is for today and that God has made that available. And so your chart, your pie chart would be full of good things that God has promised in His Word that you believe. And if your pastor or if I were to preach on any one of those subjects, you would be in total agreement. You'd be probably taking notes and you'd probably think of other points and other scriptures that confirm what we're teaching in these areas. You could have an area that would be victory and an area that would represent peace. You believe that God wants you to have peace that passes all understanding. The chastisement of our peace was upon Him. God wants us to have peace, not as the world gives, but as He gives. That's part of your belief system. That's part of your doctrinal foundation. Those represent the things you believe. So your pie chart would be full. But did you know Jesus didn't say that you can have whatever you believe? He didn't say that, not in Mark 11:23. If he did, then all that whole pie chart would be, you'd be experiencing everything in your belief system. You'd be living in the reality of it right now. But Jesus said He'll have whatever He says. And that makes it a little different, because that means that even though you have a full pie of beliefs, you're only going to experience those that you're speaking consistently. And, you know, we've spent some time on this subject, and I'm glad, because, in fact, I carved this time out. I wasn't going to spend 3 weeks on confession, but I felt like it's so important that we just needed to stop, and I just needed to take time and teach this out. And I haven't had time to do this in years, the way we're doing it here, but it's just that important. You know, you have the doctrine, and if you don't, you can get it quickly. You get into the Word, get some good teachings on all these subjects, the Holy Spirit, healing, prosperity, victory. Get all these subjects and teach, feed on them, get the Word on them. But realize this, that you have what you say, not just what you believe. And that makes it different, because it's so easy when we live in this natural world to get caught up in the things of this world and to connect our words not to our faith, our pie chart. Our words are not always connected to those things we believe. Because when you live in this world and things go wrong and things happen, you are very aware of what you see and what you feel. And if you don't make a decision, like James said, to bridle your tongue, actually control your tongue, you're going to find yourself saying what you feel, and that can be really negative, really bad, really anti-scriptural. You're going to find yourself saying what you see, and then you're going to do what the children of Israel did. You're going to put those things together and start predicting and say, you know what, it's bad today, but it's getting worse, and it's going to be terrible, and things are just, the bottom's dropped out, and it's never going to be the same. And you can go down that road before you know it, a word of faith Christian, and you can spend a whole week, a whole month, months of your life saying things that directly contradict what you say you believe. And if a preacher were to preach on it, you would totally agree with it. But in practice, we spend days on end denying the things that we think we believe. So what we've got to do is unhook our tongue from our feelings, because it's the most natural thing in the world to feel sad and talk sadness. I mean, I'm a talker. That's what I do. It's so hard for me sometimes not to say exactly what I feel, because I could make it really clear. I can take my feelings and put them into words and draw a picture and really express these things. But that is counterproductive to your faith. And you know, if you don't have teaching on confession, you can go along for years undermining your faith on a daily basis and never really know what you're doing. And so that's where I come in. And you know, I didn't really want to spend 3 weeks talking about this, but I know myself, I need to revisit this subject regularly, because it helps me rein in my tongue and get it back on track and say, you know what? I would love to tell you what I feel right now. I would love to tell you what I'm concerned about right now and what it looks like, but I don't have that luxury. I'm going to stick with what I believe. I'm going to say what I believe, and I'm going to believe what I say, and I'm going to say what God said. And that will change the direction of your life. You are going to enjoy and live in and walk in the things that you believe in your belief system that you're consistently saying. It just makes all the sense in the world. If you were to, and I'd go back to this a lot because it's something we can all see and visualize. But if you get married, you walk down an aisle and you make a confession. And the confession is, I do. And hopefully, your fiance says, I do. You both say, I do. You accept one another. And from that day forward, you talk about marriage differently. You don't go back and talk like you're single. You don't the next day say, well, I thought I was married. I'm not sure I am now. I don't know. I'm not sure if it worked. I'm not sure that we are really connected, or I don't know. You don't do that with marriage. Once you have that moment and make that confession, your words about that topic change from that day forward. From that day forward, it's, I'm married. I got married. We've been married. We're married. We're husband and wife. We share home. We share our life together. We share a name. We're married. It changes, and it never goes back. Well, if you don't do that with certain doctrines, prosperity. If you accept Jesus as your provider and you believe God to meet all your needs according to His riches and glory, and you confess that, you know, that God is able to make all grace abound toward you, that you always having all sufficiency in all things, you have to talk differently about your finances from that day forward. And if you don't, you're undermining your faith. So if all those things are true and you accepted it as true in your life, then you don't have the right and the luxury to talk about poverty and lack in the present tense any longer. Why? Jesus is my provider. Yeah, but what if I don't have enough? You don't confess that. You confess God is my provider. He is able to make all grace abound toward me. And we're going to talk about how to do this in a practical way, so I'm getting ahead of myself just a little bit. But the point is, your confession has to go along with what you believe in your heart long term for it to work in your life. And once you do that, I mean, I've crossed the line when it comes to finances. There are things that I just can't say. Just like I can't say I'm single and I'm not married. I can't say that. Why? Because I said I do and I meant it. And so I'm still married. And I'll never say that I'm single as long as my wife is still alive. I won't say that. Well, there are things like that about finances. I can't say that I'm broke. I can't say I can't afford it. I can't say I'm poor. And sometimes my finances would say otherwise. But I'm not going there. Why? I don't believe it. I believe that I can afford whatever I need because my God supplies all my needs. And when it gets slim and it gets thin, I am not going to change my confession. I am still provided for by God. I will not go back. I will not say I'm poor. Even if everybody in the world says, you look poor to me, I'm not going to say that. Why? Because God is my provider. And I said this back when I made $4 an hour and I paid taxes, full taxes out of that. And I gave 20% away. I said it then and I say it now. I am not broke. I am not poor. I have whatever I need to do the will of God. Once you cross that line, then you have possessed one of the promises, blessings that God has promised in His Word. It'd be like taking Jericho and then taking Ai and taking all these different cities in the promised land. There can be a battle to possess it, but once you cross that line, you just don't go back. Because Jesus said, you'll have whatever you say. So if you're going to walk in prosperity, never, never speak poverty again. And as that sinks in, you'll find areas in your life that you can make vast improvements. And this does not take long. You can do this so easily because we're talking anyway all day. Just watch what you say and begin to say things that agree with what God said and refuse to contradict God's promises with your words. Well, praise God. I hope this is helping you. It's helping me. I knew it would, because these things just need to be refreshed from time to time so we can watch what we're saying and stay on track. If you're enjoying this, contact our ministry. Our helpline is open. Please call us. We'd love to hear from you. Visit my website. We've got lots of free things on there and ways you can connect. We'd love to hear from you today. We're all out of time. Hope you'll be with us next time. Until then, remember this, the good news is so good, the bad news doesn't matter.
Learn what true biblical confession is and what it is not in this new series. To order your copy of this series, call our helpline at 918-749-7744 Monday through Friday from 8 a.m. to 4 p.m. Central Time.